just hit. That work?
Yeah, that's good.
Everybody good?
Mm-hmm. Do you need me to scroll?
Yeah, the paper. Well, I might be able to.
Welcome back. I understand all jurors are present. Are there any matters that we need to take up before we bring jurors in?
Just briefly, Your Honor, I want to go, we had filed a motion concerning any references to defendants, allegations the defendant had engaged in homosexual conduct. In talking about the motion, one of the things that the state had brought up is if we tried to cross-examine about affairs that Ms. Allen had, that could open the door to that. I would point out that they asked questions about the affairs and allegations about and suggestions about Mr. Holden as well. And I just want to say that it would be our position that we would be able to at least go as far as they did in cross-examination and not be at risk of opening the door to anything on that regard.
I don't disagree with that.
All right. I think that's fine. We'll just leave it like that for the time being, but I think since the state doesn't take a strong position one way or the other, I think that question will allow limited cross-examination on those topics and the original ruling would remain in place. Anything else?
No, sir.
All right, let's bring jurors, please.
The courthouse and filing for a domestic violence protective order and for custody. Is that right?
That's correct.
That's where we stopped yesterday.
Yes.
According to your recollection as well? Okay. Well, let's fast forward to January 2nd then, that morning. Tell us a little bit about how your day began.
So the officer told me that first thing in the morning I need to go down and file for a restraining order. And that will protect me, the kids, and my family. So I got the girls up for school and was heading to their school to drop them off. And when I got there, I saw his truck parked in the front of the school waiting.
When you say his truck, who are you referring to?
Nathan's truck.
And you said you were taking the girls with you to, or to school. Was JT with you at that point on January 2nd?
No, sir.
Where was he staying?
He was staying with his dad at that time.
Okay. About what time did you get to the school on January 2nd?
I can't remember.
Was it 7, 8, 9, do you recall?
Probably around 8.
Okay. What type of truck did the defendant drive back on January 2nd?
It's a Chevrolet navy blue truck.
Were you expecting to see the defendant at the school that morning, ma'am?
No, sir.
What did you do once you saw the defendant's truck
at the school? I immediately put my car in reverse and backed up all the way out to the back of the street because I knew if he would have seen me, I wouldn't have been able to go down to file the restraining order. So I backed up and I called my dad to meet me to come get the girls so that I could go downtown to file the restraining order.
So you and the defendant didn't have any kind of interaction there that morning at the school?
No, sir.
Were you able to meet up with your dad?
Yes, sir.
Where did y'all meet?
We met like right off the highway. So he met me right off of 264. So that I could just jump on the highway and go straight downtown.
Did you give the girls to your dad that morning?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And did he take them on to school?
I don't think so.
Okay.
I can't remember.
Okay. What did you do after you dropped the girls off with your dad?
I jumped on the highway and started heading downtown to file the paperwork.
And when you say downtown, are you referring to downtown Raleigh here?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And you said you were coming to the courthouse. Which courthouse were you going to go to?
The old courthouse across the street.
When was the first time that you had contact with the defendant that morning?
He was calling my phone. Then the whole time, I just ignored it. And the first contact that I got, it was a text that said, "What floor are you on?"
And when you saw that text, what did that mean to you?
I knew he was there. I immediately was just scared. And I left.
Where were you? You said you left. Where were you that you
I was from? Trying to get the paperwork done. And they were saying, you need to have this, you need to have that, you need to get it notarized. So I was frustrated with trying to get the paperwork done. And so I was in the office, you know, collecting, making sure that I had everything that I needed. And that's when I got the text.
So you were going through the administrative process of filing for the restraining order and the child custody at that point?
Yes, sir.
After you received that text about what floor you on, where did you go?
I think I called my dad and I was like, he's here. And he was like, try to get it done, but I was like, I can't do this. It's too much. I'm scared. And I just started walking to the parking deck to my car.
And you said you were scared at that point. Why were you scared, LaTanya?
I just immediately got scared. I knew, you know, that he was upset. He was really upset because he was calling me all that morning, and I was just ignoring it and just trying to get the paperwork filed. I was getting frustrated, and I knew he was there. And
the combination of what had happened the previous day and him being at the school and then the repeated calls and texts that morning.
Yes, sir.
Where did you go at that point, LaTanya?
I went to the BB&T parking deck where my car was parked.
What happened there?
As soon as I got to my car to unlock it, he immediately pulled out of his truck. He was kind of parked down, a couple of vehicles down. He immediately pulled out and pulled up behind my car.
Were you able to get your in a position where you could get your car out of the parking space?
No, sir.
At that point, how did that interaction proceed?
He began cursing me out. He was very upset, yelling, cursing. He was fierce.
Do you recall exactly what he was saying to you? And you said it's cuss words. That's fine. Say what he said.
What the fuck you doing? You trying to file papers on me? What you doing? What you up to? I'm trying to call you. He was just rambling. I couldn't get a word in. So,
I think you said that he looked mad at that point.
He was upset, very upset.
What about his demeanor led you to that opinion that he was mad and upset?
Throwing his hands up in the air, pointing at me and yelling, cursing in my face. I couldn't move. I couldn't say anything. I couldn't drive out. And all I could do was try to calm him down. And I was like, I can't talk to you here. Let's just go somewhere and talk. Trying to calm him down. And I said, just follow me. And I was like, just follow me. I said, we'll go somewhere and talk, but I couldn't talk to him at that time.
When you say he was in your face, how close was
he? Very close. Just as close as I am to this microphone.
And was he talking about the kids or the restraining order or everything?
No, he was just mad at me for not answering the phone and knowing that he had a inclination that I was going to file for the restraining order, for the custody of the kids.
Now, you said you were scared at this point, is that
yes,
right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. What were you telling him to try and calm him down?
Just like, I can't talk. You're not letting me talk. I said, let's just go somewhere and talk. I said, let's just sit down, go somewhere and talk. So I was just trying to get back in my car, and I just told him to just follow me.
And you don't have to give me an exact hour and minute on this, Latonya, but about what time of day are we talking about at this point?
9, I believe.
The courthouse was already open?
Yes, sir.
Was it before lunch?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so sometime around mid-morning?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right, when you told the defendant, let's go somewhere and meet, did he agree to do that?
Yes.
Where were you going to go?
I didn't know.
Did you say we'll have lunch, or what did you tell her?
I said we'll just sit down and eat to talk. I said I haven't eaten anything. I said we can talk about this. He was mainly trying to find out what I was down here for. So I just told him to follow me. Just follow me.
Did he make any, let me ask you, did he physically touch you at that point?
No, he was just in my face, like directly in my face.
At that point, did he make any threats to physically harm you in any way?
Not at that point.
All right. Well, tell us a little bit about what happened next.
So he moved up so I can get my car out, and I drove around to pay for the ticket, and as soon as I paid, I tried to drive, like once the thing went down, I tried to drive off as fast as I could to get away from him. And so it went down and I just sped up and just pulled out, and I think I ran a light just trying to get away, and he followed me, and everything's escalated from there, because he like ran me off the road right here at this in front of the public safety building at the intersection, and throwing his hands up, what the fuck you doing, and where you trying to go, you trying to run from me? He was just yelling, and I was like pushed off on the side of the road.
Do you know if you were you on Salisbury Street at that point, or Fayetteville Street?
It's the road right beside public safety building. So I came around where Chick-fil-A was, made that immediate left, and right at that intersection, the public safety building would be on your right. So right there, as soon as you go through the intersection, I was pulled over. He blocked me in there.
And how was your car blocked at that point?
I had to run off the road so he wouldn't hit me. So it was just like off into where the EMS workers would drive in, kind of like right in their spot.
The bays where the ambulance trucks
come
in and out of?
Yes.
All right, tell us a little bit about what happened there once your car was pulled to the side of the road.
He's still yelling, and I was like, I'm just trying to think of where to go. You know, I was just trying to think of where to go. Just follow me. I was like, I'm not trying to. He's like, you trying to run from me. And I was like, I'm not trying to run from you. I said, just follow me.
Let me interrupt you there. Was he in or out of his truck at this point?
He was in his truck.
Okay. Where were you?
In my car.
Okay. So this is happening. I guess windows are rolled down and he's hollering at you that way.
Yes, sir.
Okay. How long would you say that you were there on the side of the road?
Not long at all.
Again, at this point, did he make any threats to physically harm you?
Not at this point.
Okay. What happened at that point in time?
I drove up to the light and I circled around the courthouse and came around and I ended up parking. I was just nervous. I didn't know where to go, what to do. And I felt like I didn't need to be away from the police station. So I was like, I need to be around people. At that point, so all I could think about was talking to him right here in front of the public safety building. So I circled around the courthouse, came back around here at this intersection, and parked at the little, it wasn't a parking deck, but it's right beside the public safety building, and I parked there.
And that's a fairly, I guess, just a regular looking parking lot.
Yes.
And is that one of those lots where you put your money in a box?
Yes, sir.
Okay. When you left the parking deck, it sounds like that was one of those standard, somebody at a booth and a gate goes up and down.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And this is different. This is an open air lot.
Yes.
Were you able to find a parking space in there?
Yes, sir. I think we both did park there. And this is when I got out the car and things just started escalating from there because he was just yelling. He was in my face. And I was trying to put the money in the machine and I just kept dropping it because he's yelling at me. I'm nervous. And he's saying, I don't know what I'm going to do. He's like, I don't know what I'm capable of doing right now. He's like, I ought to punch you right now. And at that time, I'm trying to put my money in, and he had his fist just pressing it up against my face. And I was dropping my money, and the person beside me was trying to help me pick it up to put it in. I was just nervous at that time. That's when he began to make the threats.
You said he had his fist literally on your face at that point?
Yes, pressed up against my face.
Is that the first time that he had touched you that day?
Yes, sir.
And to go back to the entire relationship, was this the first time that he had put hands on you like
yes,
that?
Yes, sir.
And y'all had been married, I guess, about 11 years at that point and dated before that. Describe the demeanor that you saw that day in relation to what you'd seen from the defendant over 15 years.
I mean, he was just yelling. He was very, very upset. I was just shaking, and he was just yelling. I couldn't even get a word in. It seemed like whatever I would say, he would just get even more upset.
And at that point, he told you he didn't know, what he was capable of
doing. Yes.
What did you take that to mean, Latonya?
I knew that I didn't need to go anywhere. I needed to be in a safe place. I needed to get somewhere safe. So I was just saying, well, okay, let me sit down. I told him, let me sit down and we can talk. And he's like, I just want to talk to you. So once I paid the toll, we walked across the street and I said, I will talk to you, but I will talk to you right here in front of this police station. And I sat right there on the bench in front of the public safety building. And I was sitting there, and he was standing directly in front of me, and he just was just yelling at me the whole time. People were walking by. I couldn't say anything at that point, and I don't even remember all what he was saying, just rambling, just yelling, just in my face, pointing his finger in my face. It was scared. I was scared.
Was he still cursing at you?
Yes,
at
sir. Okay.
And you say you don't remember exactly what he said, but it was the same general tone of the conversation that you'd had all morning.
Yes, sir.
Okay. You mentioned that he threatened to punch you in the parking lot. Did he make any physical threats to you there on the bench in front of the public safety center?
Yes, he did. Kept saying that I don't know what I'm capable of doing. I don't know. He's like, I'm just upset. He's like, I can do anything. I can do anything. That's what he was saying.
And Latonya, were you in fear for your safety and life at this point?
Yes.
How about the kids? Was he talking about the kids at all at this point in the conversation?
He was saying something like, you're trying to take my kids away from me. And I was like, I'm not trying to do that. That's not what I'm trying to do. That's not. But like I said, anything that I said, any little word, he would just get louder and louder.
You've described him as upset and yelling at you. Let me ask you, at that point, did you think that the defendant was impaired in any way?
No, sir.
Okay. Whether it be on marijuana or drugs or alcohol?
No.
During the course of your relationship, have you seen the defendant impaired or high at times?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And when he's impaired, does he act out in this rage that you've described this?
No, sir.
Okay. So this was something different than what you had seen before?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And while I'm here, we'll take a little break from talking about January 2nd for a minute. Talking about drugs and alcohol, you mentioned yesterday that the defendant was a barber. Do you know if he was involved in selling drugs as well?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Were you aware of him selling drugs?
Yes, sir.
And where would he sell those drugs?
For a while, he never, I don't know where he kept it at, but close to the end of our marriage, he started keeping it at home.
Where at home?
In the bathroom.
Did you talk to the defendant about him selling drugs there out of your house?
I did when we first, when he first started back selling drugs, which is probably shortly after the youngest child was born. And that was the thing when we got married, that was the agreement that we said, you know, that I said, you cannot, you know, go back to selling drugs, you know. But when he started back, he told me how I felt about it didn't matter. So I didn't have a say in him selling drugs or not in the house.
So you told him you were opposed to it and specifically selling drugs out of the house where you had young children?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and how did he respond?
He didn't care at that point. We was living in Jonesville, and he didn't care how I felt about it. You know, I was very upset about it when I found out, and he didn't care. He was like, it's what I'm going to do. It's, you know, I didn't have a say in it.
And Amber is the youngest child. When was she born again?
2006.
Okay. All right. We'll go back to January 2nd now. And so your opinion was that he wasn't impaired in any way this morning.
No, sir.
All right. So y'all are still outside fighting on the, or he's yelling at you, I guess I should say, in front of the public safety center. How long would you say you were out there with him yelling at you like this?
I would say it probably went on about 10 minutes, not long, but it seemed long, but I don't think we was out there that long.
Any bystanders come by and try and separate him?
Nobody helped. Nobody. They was looking at us like just looking and staring. Some people would walk by really, really fast. I was hoping that an officer or somebody would stop. But.
So no law enforcement got involved at that point?
No, sir.
How were you able to, I guess, stop this in front of the public safety center?
His main argument was that I wouldn't talk to him. So I said, well, I haven't eaten anything. I'm tired. I'm stressed. I'm nervous. I'm scared. I said, let's just go somewhere and sit down and eat and talk. And he eventually agreed to that. And so I told him to just follow me. So,
did you have a plan at that point where to go, LaTanya?
In my mind, I was thinking Golden Corral on Capitol Boulevard.
Is that somewhere you'd been before?
Yes, sir.
And that Golden Corral, does it have a lot of people at it?
Yes, sir.
So did you walk back over to that parking, I guess the parking lot?
Yes.
Who, you get in your vehicle, he got in his vehicle?
Yes, sir.
What type of vehicle were you driving at that
point? Dodge Avenger.
Did y'all leave the parking lot?
Yes.
Okay. Tell us what happened there.
So I started heading down towards New Bern Avenue. And just before you get to Bojangles, I got a call from JT's school, and it was an officer, and my phone had been ringing all that morning. I think I had missed calls from my brother, my dad, my mom, Nathan, and so the school called, and they said, is this Miss Holden? I said, yes.
When you say they said?
The officer, he said.
A school resource officer?
Yes. He said,
Objection, Your Honor, we would ask that the parents go to the instruction.
Sure.
I'm sorry, I think we'd be asking for limited instruction.
So, ladies and gentlemen, the statement that's being referred to here in the evidence is an out-of-court statement not made under oath. It's being allowed solely for the purposes of explaining what this witness did next. You're not to take it for the truth of what was being said in that statement because, again, it's not under oath in this courtroom. But you may answer the question, and the jury is to use it solely for the purposes permitted.
Thank you, sir. LaTanya, this officer, did he identify himself as a school resource officer?
Yes, he did.
Do you know his name or?
He gave me his name, but I can't remember.
Okay, what did the officer tell you at that point, ma'am?
He told me that he said that he was the resource officer from JT School, and that he had got a call from my brother saying that. He asked me, where's Nathan? And I was like, thinking, how did he know him? I said, he's behind me. He's following me. He said, well, I got a call from your brother stating that he said he would kill you and the kids today, that it was going to all end today, and that I needed to get back. I said, he said, where are you? I said, I'm downtown. He's following me. We're going to go get something to eat to talk about this. He said, you need to go back downtown. You need to go to the police station.
And you said that he received a call from your brother. And I know your brother and your father,
yes.
Sylvester. Do you recall if it was your brother or your father that he said he'd heard from?
I think he said my brother.
Okay. All right. And so he told you you need to get back down to the public safety center.
Yes, sir.
What did you do at that point, LaTanya?
I made a quick U-turn where Bojangles and Cookout is at. So I made a U-turn, and I just started speeding downtown. And I was just weaving in and out of cars. And he's, like, speeding behind me, throwing up his arms. I'm just like, just follow me. Just, you know, waving him, just follow me. And I pulled up in front of the public safety building. I just drove up, ran out, left my car there, ran out, and ran inside. And I said, my husband is trying to kill me. I need some help. And they took me to the back.
So you essentially just abandoned your car down.
I did.
Salisbury Street here.
Yes.
And now you said you told the first officer you saw that your husband had threatened to kill you. Why'd you tell him that?
Because that's what the officer had said, that he had made threats to do that today.
I'm sorry. And LaTanya, were you still on the phone with the resource officer at this point, or did you hang up?
I think I handed the phone to the lady at the front, or the officer that came to meet me.
Where were you able to see where the defendant was at this point once you ran inside?
No, sir. They took me back into a secure place and held me there.
did he follow you into the public safety center?
I'm not sure. I was in the back, so I don't. They came in and told me they didn't see him. They didn't see that vehicle or see him.
When you abandoned your car there on Salisbury Street, do you recall if the defendant's truck was still behind you at that point?
No, it wasn't.
So you were able to put a little distance between yourself and him at that
point? Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, LaTanya, you said that you got some people to help you with the restraining order. Who were those folks?
I don't remember their name. It was a lady officer, and she escorted me to the old courtroom, and she was like, take your time, get your paperwork done. I was able to bypass some couple of people and just go straight in and get everything that I needed to get done. I also filed for full custody of the kids at that time.
So it was a Wake County Sheriff's deputy that walked you over there. Well, Tanya, tell us a little bit about the process that you had to go through to apply for a restraining order that morning.
It was a form you fill out, and I think you had to meet with the judge at a certain time to meet with the judge to grant the temporary custody.
And so did you, in fact, fill out your paperwork there that morning?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And that morning, were you also able to go in front of a judge and be heard on your issues?
Yes, sir.
Okay. May I approach the witness, Your Honor?
Yes, sir. As you step into the deliberation room for a moment, again, please don't concern yourself about what's occurring in the courtroom during your absence. These are matters the law requires us to consider outside your presence, and leave your notepads. Don't talk about the case among yourselves. Outside the presence of the jury, Mr. Brown.
I'm going through some of this, and I see, and I probably need to take it in a moment, but some things that I would argue should be redacted, or at least have limited instructions about. I mean, one example is there was a statement in the domestic violence order that says he may be a convicted felon, which is actually not true. He doesn't have a felony record, so I think that would be misleading, and I would argue that should be redacted. And I can just have a moment. I have seen this material beforehand, but I just want Ms. Hamburger and I, if we could just have a moment to look through and see other things that might be an issue. questions. In the domestic violence sheet, the one that I moved, I said particularly about he may be a convicted felon. My understanding of Mr. Holden's record is he has no felony convictions. If I'm wrong, that's I think my understanding is that's the state's understanding too, and I think having that in order. There's also, again, the reference and to, you know, he told the police my brother was going to kill the kids and himself. I think at least a limiting instruction would be appropriate with that. I don't, on the complaint for child custody visitation ones, I don't object to some of the paperwork, but there are some conclusions by the court, particularly after the second hearing, that I believe are impermissible in a criminal hearing. I think the pleadings itself could be a different story, but I think if the civil court makes findings of it, I think there was, I don't have the site, but I know that was a concern in the Jason Young case, and I know that was eventually overturned by the North Carolina Supreme Court, but I don't think on the validity of the claim, I think it was what it was actually constituted in effective assistance of counsel. I don't have that site, but there was a specific statute about that.
All right, so. Mr. Waller, what's your
What's your intention with these documents? Are you seeking to publish them?
Yes, sir. I would seek to publish them. If Mr. Brown can let me know which on regarding the child custody issues referring to, I'll be glad to look at those and see where we are. But in regards to convicted felon, I can, if you want, Your Honor wants to see the, it's her complaint under the ex parte order that Judge Mangum filed. It does have pistol. This defendant may be a convicted felon, and it's underlined at that point. My argument to you would be that it says may, and two, I can ask LaTanya about that. He's not a convicted felon, so I could ask her about that. And some sort of limiting instruction, I believe, would cure that.
If you have a copy, it would be helpful for me to. Do you have an extra copy?
I have my copy.
All right, that's fine. I can just accept your description of it. All right. Whose handwriting is that? Is that Judge Mangum?
It looks like that's Judge Mangum's handwriting because that comes directly off the order. If I may approach, I'll show you Miss Allen's handwriting.
Okay. As I'm looking through this, it looks like it is findings of fact here that said the defendant threatened to kill the children, and I would object to a finding by the district court that he threatened to kill the children. And that's on page 5458, which I believe is the bait stamps from the district attorney's office.
This may come out of a different bait stamp set. Okay. There were several.
All right.
Page
2
of
5
of the AOC document. It's the same page the defendant may be a convicted felon. I think there's several. It appears that this, one of these is, it's additional findings, and I guess I would object to these findings of facts under the statute that I'm sorry I don't have the specific one, but I think that right. We both know we right. Talking about.
I'm familiar with that as well. It's, for what purpose would Judge Mangum's findings be admissible?
His actual findings?
Right.
I will tell you, I'm probably more concerned just with the order itself.
The fact that an order was entered.
Yes, sir. That an order was entered, that it tells about certain dates, what he's prohibited to do, that sort of thing. The right. Findings.
Right. I think that's admissible. I think that the objection is well taken as to what a judge in an ex parte civil proceeding might have entered as findings of fact.
Sir.
That may be unduly prejudicial. And so I think what would be admissible is any pleadings that this witness herself created or right, submitted or created her pleadings. The order itself, there may be portions of the written order that would need to be redacted, but certainly the language of what is permitted, what's not permitted, that sort of thing would be admissible as well. But in terms of, for example, this additional findings page, I'm not sure that really any of it would be admitted, just simply, yeah, so that the defendant threatened to kill the children. That's, yeah, now Judge Mangum considering what Miss Allen told him that her brother told her through a resource officer. It seems to get pretty remote at this point.
Yes, sir.
So I think what we're looking at is the, again, the order itself, the pleadings that Miss Allen prepared to get that order, I think those would be admissible. And if the pleadings themselves contain language about a threat to kill, then that can be cured with a limiting. Yes, I do see that here. So that can be cured with a limiting instruction that that's to be considered solely for the purposes of explaining the source of that information for this witness and explaining why she took certain actions, and it's not to be considered for the truth of the matter asserted. All right. Anything else that we need to take up on that?
This one is also that
the issue of the custody for child, custody visitation, pleading too. That's the, I don't know if you can give them copies of that.
I don't have a copy of that either.
If those are the originals, if you want to hand those up and let Judge
there's
Ridgway examine.
There's also examples of both pleadings that I would not object to, but to
conclusions by the court. I think we run into the same issue.
We've got a complaint prepared by Miss Allen. We've got an affidavit as to status of minor child. We've got answer and counterclaim prepared by a lawyer for Mr. Holden, an affidavit of Mr. Holden. So no objection to any of those materials. Is that my understanding? Okay. Then we had an ex parte order that was entered on January 30, 2014. It has some findings of fact that minor children are exposed to a substantial risk of physical injury, things of that sort. So you're objecting to the findings of the court?
More specifically, although probably to be consistent, both, but more specifically, I think there's findings of fact from the February 10th order.
All right.
That's more what we were objecting to.
Okay, well, I think we do need to be consistent. Okay, so this order actually grants. The defendant emergency custody, and then we have a temporary order of February 10, 2014, which grants Mrs. Allen primary custody of the two daughters, I gather. All right. Well, I think that I think what I would say is that the substance of the order can be testified to as to the legal effect of it. If you want to redact it and put it into evidence, you can, or it can just be testified to, whatever you prefer. But I think, again, the findings of the court are not
so
relevant.
Under the temporary order from February 10th, redact, I guess, 1 through 17.
Yes.
And then also 1 through 7?
Yes.
Okay. And that's the February 10th hearing.
Right.
And then on the other ones?
Right.
The domestic violence, and I've given Your Honor my copy, if I may.
Yes, sir. That would just be, I think, the findings. I don't have the actual order portion of that. I just have the additional findings.
Yes, sir.
Are you seeking to admit the January 30?
January 30.
That's the ex parte order that allowed Mr. Holden emergency custody over three children.
Yes, sir.
You are seeking.
Yes, sir.
So, be the same ruling as to the middle paragraph, it appearing to the court. I think that's the portion that would be redacted.
Okay.
Although I would permit redaction of it, but it may be that there's no objection to that portion coming in, and you may wish to have it come in. So if there's no objection, then.
I don't have any objections to that part of it.
Right. So, but
I think at this point I will redact all findings of fact and conclude findings of fact by,
I think to
by
be
the
consistent
court.
That would be allowed. Well, so in the January 10th or January 30th, February 10th orders, the findings would be redacted, and the conclusions of law would be redacted. All that would appear would be that portion that appears after the words "now, therefore, it's hereby ordered." Adjudged and decreed. Similarly, on the domestic violence protective order, the order would be permitted, but the additional findings would not be allowed.
Okay. If Your Honor would allow me, I can do it a couple ways. Either we can take a 15-20 minute break for me to redact this information, or two, I can go through and have LaTanya, I guess the dates are what are important and what she was allowed to do and what the defendant was allowed to do. I can go through that with her now using the unredacted portions and move to introduce those documents at a later time, allowing me time to redact them and enter them. She may even be off the stand at that point. It's how Your Honor wishes for me to proceed.
I would prefer it that way. We'll probably take a break within 45 minutes, so she may still be on the stand, or I don't know how much longer you have, but I'd certainly allow you to move for the admission later on and then also publish them later on if you care to.
Yes, sir.
All right.
That would be fine either way.
Okay. So I don't know whose copies I have up here, but I'm happy to return
those. Those are all my those are my originals that I was getting ready to publish or introduce. So.
All right.
I've handed I've given Mr. Brown and Ms. Hamburger the DV paperwork I intend to introduce, custody information that I intend to reduce. I've also given them her divorce proceedings that I intend to introduce. And one of those divorce proceedings does include a letter from the defendant in response to her complaint for absolute divorce. So that's the paperwork I intend to introduce over the next portion of Ms. Allen's testimony.
Okay. So all of the pleadings can come in now, can be admitted now. The only documents that we're talking about are the actual court orders from the district court. So,
yes, sir.
But everything else can come in now, be published now. As far as I'm concerned, I'll give the appropriate limiting instruction. All right.
May I approach?
Yes, please. All right, anything else, or are we ready for the jury?
If I may have just 1 minute to get everything back in order. Alan about during the course of the upcoming testimony is specifically on, in the temporary order for custody. Under the order of the court, one of it outlines the custody arrangement that would have been in place as of February 10th. It also outlines at that point the Taylor family was ordered to remove any weapons from their property. That's fair game at this point, and in terms of her testimony, is my understanding.
We, I think that is fair game.
Right, so just the findings of fact and conclusions of law, but orders are fair.
Right.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Further questions, Mr. Waller?
Yes, Your Honor, thank you. May I approach?
Yes, sir.
LaTanya, I'm going to hand you a series of documents that we're going to work through, and I'll hand them to you one at a time, and I'll let you know the evidence number I'm looking at. We'll start with what has been identified at this point as State's Exhibit 47. I'd ask that you take a look at this document and tell me if you recognize what these documents appear to be, and take your time and we'll flip them. You recognize those documents?
Yes, sir.
And LaTanya, just make, when you're moving away from the microphone, just make sure you keep your voice up. Stuff moving back and forth. But do you recognize what State's Exhibit 47 appears to be?
Yes, sir.
And what does State's Exhibit 47 appear to be, ma'am?
This is the application I had to complete to get the restraining order, the 50B.
Okay. And when you say 50B, that order is, we called it a restraining order, but it's technically a domestic violence protective order.
Yes, sir.
Now, is that your handwriting on State's Exhibit 47, the actual application process?
Yes, sir.
And Ms. Allen, does that appear to be the same or at least a copy of the application process that you filled out on January 2nd of 2014?
Yes, sir.
Any changes or alterations that you see?
No, sir.
Your Honor, at this time, I would ask to introduce State's Exhibit 47 in evidence.
Any objection?
no objection except for what we had previously discussed.
All right, 47 is allowed.
And if I may borrow that from you, LaTanya, I want to specifically go to, well, we'll start with the information sheet, and then ask you a series of questions about whether or not you have ever filed a 50B complaint against the defendant, or he has filed a complaint against you, ever charged with any crimes involving this defendant. And how did you respond to each one of those questions on the information sheet?
I responded as no for all of those questions.
So you'd never filed for a restraining order against the defendant?
No, sir.
Okay. Let's go to line item number 4 on your complaint and motion for domestic violence protective order. It outlines your relationship, that y'all are spouses, that you have children, and there's not any current proceedings involving you two as parties. But then in line item number 4, it asks you to allege your specific complaints against the defendant. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and I want you to read to the jury what you put in line item number 4.
I have moved out of my home, separated, and he continues to call me and my parents, threatening to take my children. He attempted to come to my parents' home, and my father called the police. He told my brother he was going to kill the kids and himself. He threatened to punch me. He beat my son with a broom.
All right, and ladies and gentlemen, again, the out-of-court statement relating to her brother is to be considered by you solely for the purposes of explaining what this witness believed and what she did. It's not to be accepted for the truth of what was asserted in that out-of-court statement. Go ahead.
Thanks. Let's walk through each one of those allegations briefly together. When you say you moved out of the home, that you'd separated, that's what you did back on December 20th of 2000.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then moving on to the next item, you say he continues to call me and parents threatening to take my children. He attempted to come to my parents' home, and my father called the police. What is that in reference to, LaTanya?
January the 1st, 2014.
So the previous day?
Yes, sir.
And then the matter we were just discussing, he told my brother he was going to kill the kids and himself. What is that in reference to?
Earlier that day, from the phone call from the school officer. From JT school.
School resource officer.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then you say he threatened to punch me. What was the basis of that allegation?
That day when he was chasing me around downtown.
The January 2nd day?
Yes, sir.
And specifically over there in the parking lot?
Yes, sir.
And then he beat my son with a broom. What is that in regards to?
The incident in December of the end of 2013.
Prior to
the separation.
Okay. Then you go and you outline the three children involved in the case, that Jeremy, Nautica, and Amber. You put their names down, and at that point you check that you believe there was serious or immediate injury to the children. Is that right?
That's right.
And what was that based on, Ms. Allen?
Just concern for their safety.
Then in line item number 7, you say that you don't want him to come to your residence, place where you work, place where your children receive daycare, any places where you're temporarily residing, in any schools that the children attend, and you put down Forest Road Elementary and Roseville High School. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
You ask for no contact from the defendant. And at that point, you also, as part of this domestic violence protective order, process, ask for temporary custody of the children. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
And the form indicates that you also have to take some other steps to get custody of the children as well, right?
Yes, sir.
And you did that same day?
Yes.
We'll talk about that in just a minute. You did ask for some child support payments in regards to the two children as well, right?
Yes, sir.
And it looks like this is dated and signed by you on January 2nd of 2014. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
And it looks, there's a file stamp on the cover sheet. It looks like it, according to that file stamp, it was filed at 1:10 p.m. on that very same day. And I know you kind of were talking about times earlier today. Does 1:10 p.m. sound about right?
Yes, sir.
As when you actually filed this?
Yes.
And that was just across the street there?
Yes, sir.
Now, a moment ago, you mentioned that after you filled out the paperwork,
mm-hmm.
you had to go through and go in front of the judge. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
And you had to not only file this paperwork, but tell him what had happened as well.
Yes, sir.
And on that day, ma'am, did you in fact go in front of the district court judge?
Yes.
And to your knowledge, at that point, did he enter an order in regards to the domestic violence protective order?
Yes.
And I'm handing you what has been marked now as State's Exhibit 48. If you'll take a look at State's Exhibit 48 and tell me if you recognize what that document is.
Yes, it's a domestic violence order of protection.
And did you actually receive a copy of that document?
Yes, sir.
Now, to be clear, at this point, the defendant's not there in the courtroom as well.
Right? That's correct.
And this is entitled ex parte, and is your understanding that ex parte just means one of the parties is present?
Yes, sir.
All right. Let me ask you a few questions about this document, Tanya. In this document, did the court order that certain things happen to your with your case?
Yes.
Okay. And those orders include that, one, the defendant shall not threaten, abuse, follow, harass you in any way, interfere with the plaintiff, and a law enforcement officer shall arrest the defendant if the officer has probable cause to believe the defendant violated this provision. Is that one of the things you were told?
Yes, sir.
Number two, the defendant shall not assault, threaten, abuse, follow, harass by telephone, visiting the home or workplace or other means, or interfere with the minor children residing with or in the custody of the plaintiff. A law enforcement officer shall arrest the defendant if the officer has probable cause to believe the defendant has violated this provision. Is that one thing you were told that day?
Yes, sir.
Number three, the defendant shall not threaten a member of the plaintiff's family or household. Number eight, that the defendant shall stay away from the following places: where you were working at the time, which was AKC?
Yes, sir.
Is that the
American Kennel Club?
The place where the children receive daycare, other from stay 100 yards away from the plaintiff and children at all times, and he was ordered to stay away from the school. And that includes Forestville Elementary and Roseville High School. That was ordered that day?
Yes, sir.
Number 10, the plaintiff is awarded temporary custody of the minor children, and the defendant is ordered to stay away from the minor children, and the defendant is ordered to not remove the children from the care or of the plaintiff, and you were the plaintiff in this case, right?
Yes, sir.
It was also ordered that the defendant is prohibited from possessing or receiving or purchasing a firearm for the protective period of this order. And then number 13, the defendant is to surrender to the sheriff serving this order the firearms, ammunition, and gun permits described in number 3 of the order. And that you recall that being told to you as well?
Yes, sir.
And Judge Mangum entered this order back on January 2nd of 2014, and it looks like it was file stamped at 2:15 p.m., so the very same day.
Yes, sir.
In regards to the firearm question, Ms. Allen, do you know at that time if your ex-husband, the defendant, had a firearm?
Yes, sir, he did.
Can you describe that firearm for the members of the jury?
A black pistol.
Where did he keep that pistol?
He normally kept it near the bed.
Near the bed?
Yes.
Did he keep it in any type of container, or was it just out in the open?
I mostly see it out in the open.
Right. And had you seen the defendant use that gun at any point, or was it just something that he possessed?
Just seen him like fired in the backyard, up in the air, but he just possessed it.
Do you know what specific caliber pistol that was?
No, sir.
So the ex parte order was entered on January 2nd, and then this ex parte order is just temporary. Was that your understanding?
Yes, sir.
And did the judge at that point order you to come back to court on a certain day?
Yes.
And looking at the state's exhibit 48, does it indicate how long this ex parte order was to last? What's that date?
January the 9th, 2014.
And was it your understanding that at that time you would have to come back to court to renew this order for a long period of time?
Yes, sir.
Was the defendant made aware that this ex parte order for domestic violence was put against him?
Yes, sir.
Okay. How was he notified about it?
I think they delivered it to his home.
And when you say they delivered, what agency?
The officers, the sheriff's department.
Now, I want to go now to State's Exhibit 49, and we just mentioned that the next time you were to be in court with the defendant on this issue was January 9th of 2014. I would ask that you take a look at State's Exhibit 49 and tell me if you recall, after looking at that document, what happened on January 9th of 2014.
Nathan requested a continuance because he wanted to retain an attorney.
And was that request granted?
Yes, sir.
What was the next court date that you were to have?
January the 21st, 2014.
So, based on that request, did you still have custody of the kid? Have custody of the kids?
Yes, sir.
And also, he was to stay away from you?
Yes, sir.
Let me ask you, in regards to these two orders, well, first of all, Your Honor, this time I would ask to introduce State's Exhibit 49 into evidence.
Other than anything that we have previously discussed,
This is, as I understand it, a motion for a continuance.
It is, Your Honor. It's a motion order for continuing the domestic violence hearing and ex parte order.
Any specific objection to that? I'm not sure that's one.
I believe that it is not any objection.
All right, very good. So it's allowed.
Thank you. You said earlier that the girls were staying with you on January 2nd and JT was with his dad. These orders provide that all the kids were supposed to stay with you at this point. Did you take steps to go and get JT from his father?
Yes, sir. And I think it was done through the CPS worker that they would set up a time where we can meet, where we would meet to where I could get Jeremy.
And did the transition or you getting custody of Jeremy, how did that actually take place?
Well, he wasn't answering the phone. He wasn't at home. And so I just called the police to kind of initiate the exchange.
And was that the same day on January 2nd, or was that a couple days later?
I think it was the same day.
And at that point, we heard from Deputy Broadwell yesterday that there was supposed to be a custody exchange.
Yes.
Is that the incident Deputy Broadwell was testifying about?
Yes.
Okay. Where you met him, I think, at a Sheets gas station?
Yes, sir.
Did the defendant ever show up to give you JT there at the Sheets gas station?
He did not, but his dad and his wife showed up later with JT.
Later with JT?
Yes.
So January 2nd, that's when you got custody of JT.
Yes, sir.
Did you allow JT to go back to the house, to his dad's house, after this order was entered?
No, sir.
I believe the next time you were in court was January 21st. Is that right, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
So were all three kids were with you up until that point?
Yes, sir.
I'm going to hand you what I'm marking as State's Exhibit number 50, and I'll ask that you take a look at State's Exhibit 50, and if you can just identify for the court what State's Exhibit 50 is. You can read that headline right there.
Domestic Violence Order of Protection Consent Order.
So on January 21st of 2014, Did you appear in court again?
Yes, sir.
And at that point, was the defendant there in court as well?
Yes, sir.
You said that this was a consent order. Were you and the defendant able to agree on this domestic violence protective order?
Yes, sir.
And did both of you, in fact, sign this document?
Yes, sir.
Just want to ask you a few questions about State's Exhibit 50. Number one, if the court orders that the above-named defendant shall not commit any further acts of domestic violence or make any threats of domestic violence. And two, the above-named defendant shall not have any contact with you, the plaintiff. No contact includes the defendant initiated contact except through an attorney, direct or indirect, by means of such telephone, personal contact, email, pager, gift-giving, fax machine. The terms shall apply in this case until January 21st of 2015. So State's Exhibit 50, the Domestic Violence Order of Protection Consent Order, was to last for a year. Is that your understanding?
Yes, sir.
In this order, ma'am, were either one of you represented by an attorney when you went through this?
No, sir.
In this order, it also provides, it again orders him to stay away from you, but it does also provide some guidance on terms of the children as well.
Yes, sir.
And number 14 of this domestic violence protective order, consent order, it says the defendant, who would be the defendant in this case, shall use no physical discipline on the children. Defendant shall have visitation with the children every other weekend from Friday after school until Sunday at 6 p.m. and other visits as mutually agreed upon. Was that the order of this court back on January 21st of 2014?
Yes, sir.
Now, subsequent to January of 21st of 2014, did you and the defendant at least initially agree that this would be the arrangement?
Yes, sir.
The court also gives notice in this case that the defendant is prohibited from possessing, receiving, or purchasing a firearm again, and he's ordered to surrender his firearm. Do you know, Ms. Allen, whether or not the defendant did in fact surrender that gun you had seen him with?
I do not know. I don't think so, no.
So you don't know?
No.
Now, let's switch gears just a little bit. You said that when you went down on January 2nd, you also filed for custody, is that right, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I'm going to hand you what has been marked now for identification purposes as State's Exhibit 51. And if you will take a look at State's Exhibit 51 and tell me if you recognize what State's Exhibit 51 is.
It's a complaint for child custody and visitation.
And is that the complaint that you filed with the district court back on January 2nd of 2014?
Yes, sir.
And does it list the three children there?
Yes, sir.
Your Honor, at this time I would ask to introduce State's Exhibit 51 into evidence.
Any objection?
Acceptable. No objection, acceptable.
All right. So this 51 is a complaint. It's allowed.
So a complaint, you have no objection?
Yes.
In State's Exhibit number 51, the original complaint, it appears that you asked the court for certain things. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
And that's the prayer for relief section. And in number two, that box is checked. And what were you asking for in regards to custody?
Temporary custody and permanent custody of the minor children would be awarded to the plaintiff.
So that's what you were asking for, and essentially the domestic violence protective order also granted you that right as well.
Yes, sir.
Or granted you the kids as well. Okay. Let's so right now we're on January 21st of 2014, and at that point you have physical custody of all three kids.
Yes, sir.
few days after January 21st of 2014, did something happen that kind of upset the custody arrangement?
The very first exchange.
Was there an issue at the first exchange?
Yes, sir.
Okay, what was that?
My dad was picking up the kids, and his dad, Nathan, and Nathan's father and Nathan's brother came along with them.
I have asked for an objection on hearsay grounds, but requesting an instruction.
Okay. Again, ladies and gentlemen, this the testimony is including out-of-court statements not made under oath in this courtroom, and so you may accept them. For the purpose of explaining her state of mind, what she believed, what she did with that information, but not for the truth of the matters asserted.
So you said this incident was the first custody exchange, so it would have been the first Friday after the 21st.
This will be that Sunday evening, the pickup.
The pickup?
Yes, sir.
So the drop-off went fine?
Yes.
The pickup is where the issue occurred?
Yes.
And was that January 26th?
Yes.
2017? Okay, tell us what happened when your dad went to pick up JT and the girls.
My dad said that the girls got in the car, Jeremy got in the car, and Nathan immediately came over and had words with my dad. I'm not sure what was said, but my dad felt like they were all ganging up on him. Or he wanted to start some type of argument with him. And so my dad left, like immediately sped off, left. And him and JT got in an argument on the way home. And so when they got home, my dad said he sent the girls inside. And him and JT was on his phone. And my dad was arguing with him, saying, you know, did you know that all of them was coming, you know? And JT was on the phone. My dad said that he slapped the phone out of JT's hand. And JT left and ran and next door to call the police.
Were you home when?
I was not at home.
When did you become aware of the situation?
I was out with my mother, and I got a phone call from my dad to come home.
And did you go immediately?
Yes, we did.
And so your dad said that he slapped the phone out of his hand. Did he say he slapped JT in the face or anything like that?
No, but he said he slapped the phone. JT had the phone up to his face, and he said he slapped the phone out of his hand.
And any other physical discipline that he gave him or gave towards JT at that point?
No, sir.
Did you talk to JT that night about when you got home about what had happened as well?
I did, and just trying to calm him down, and I just told him, just go to bed. We'll talk about it tomorrow. Everybody, you know, just calm down, and we'll deal with it in the morning.
Did he tell you specifically what had happened?
He did. He told me what had happened. He said my dad actually slapped him, and that they was arguing, and so he called his dad. He called the police.
And you say he went to a neighbor's house?
Did yes, sir.
Know these neighbors?
No, I don't.
At any point that night, that Sunday night, did JT tell you that a weapon or a gun was involved in any way?
No, sir.
All right. What happened the next day, which I guess would be Monday the 27th?
I think I was contacted by a CPS worker. And that's when we found out about JT saying something about the gun. She went to his school and interviewed him. And... And that's when it came up that my dad had a gun or pulled a gun out on him.
So JT the night before and your dad the night before didn't mention a gun in any way?
No, sir.
Do you know if your dad carried a weapon in his car or truck?
He did not.
After you got the call from the CPS worker, how did things proceed?
She just told me that Jeremy said nothing about a gun in the police report. And so she was like, you know, she was questioning that. But that was it.
And when you say the CPS worker, do you know which CPS worker that was?
Kathy.
Kathy
Sudol.
Okay. And your son, JT, is in the courtroom?
JT is here.
And you see Kathy here in the courtroom as well?
Kathy is here.
All right.
Did this change the arrangement that you had with the defendant regarding custody?
It eventually did, yes.
What happened, Ms. Allen?
He filed emergency custody.
Okay. And I'm going to hand you what has been marked now as State's Exhibit Number 52. And I'll ask that you take a look at State's Exhibit 52, and you can just identify it by its caption there on the front.
Right here.
Yes, ma'am.
Answer and counterclaim.
And was that document served on you, Ms. Allen?
Yes, sir.
And it looks like it was filed on January 30th of 2014, so a few days after the incident.
Yes, sir.
With your between your dad and JT. And in reviewing this document, is this the document that makes allegations regarding JT and your dad and the gun being pulled and the slap?
Yes, sir.
As a result of State's Exhibit Number 52, when the defendant and through his attorney makes these claims, did the court order at that point that child custody be transferred?
Yes, that Nathan would get temporary custody of JT, and that I will keep custody of the girls.
Okay, and that's what eventually happened. But before that, was there another?
Yes, the police officers, the sheriffs came and removed all the children the night this was filed.
So I'm handing you State's Exhibit number 53. What's the title of that document?
Ex parte order.
Ex parte order. Okay, and that appears that it was filed on January 30th of 2014. And in this document, the court orders that both Amber, Nautica, and JT are to be given to the custody of the defendant.
Yes, sir.
And you said the police came and took kids from you.
Yes.
From you that night.
Yes.
How was that night? What was your emotional state that night when the kids were taken from you?
Heartbroken.
And State's Exhibit 53 also outlines that you are to return in 10 days for a hearing on February 10th. Back in the Wake County Courthouse, is that right?
Yes, sir.
So let me move to State's Exhibit number 54. And if you can look at State's Exhibit number 54, and what's the title of that document, ma'am?
Temporary order.
And did you and the defendant go to court on February 10th as was ordered by the court?
Yes, sir.
And did you have an attorney at that time?
No, sir.
How about the defendant? Did he have an attorney at that point?
Yes, sir.
And in State's Exhibit number 54, you mentioned a moment ago that as part of that order, custody kind of changed between you and the defendant. Can
yes,
you
sir.
Describe that for us.
We rotated every other weekend with JT. So JT primarily lived with him, and the girls lived with me.
And so State's Exhibit number 54, this temporary order gives primary custody to you of Nautica and Amber, and primary custody of JT to the defendant.
Yes, sir.
And it describes that every other weekend situation you would describe.
Yes.
Let me also point you out to line item number 6 on the temporary order, which is State's Exhibit 54. Read what item number 6 is there in regards to that order.
Plaintiff, defendant, and maternal grandparents shall have no weapons in the residence where the minor children are residing.
So on February 10th, when you went to court, again, you were present, the defendant was present, and was that order of the court made known to the defendant at that time?
Yes, sir.
And do you know, LaTanya, why that order came into place? Had you talked with social services about that?
Yes. She said this would just probably keep the peace between JT, his dad, and should kind of diffuse the situation.
So by February 10th of 2014, had you spoken with Child Protective Services about removing all guns and weapons from your father's house?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do you know if your dad did, in fact, remove all weapons from his house?
I'm not sure. He said he did.
Your dad told you he did?
Yes.
And you were saying that you were working with Child Protective Services at this point. Did you have to sign some agreement with Child Protective Services to remove the guns from the house?
Yes, we had to sign, my mother, my dad, and myself had to sign a safety form to in agreement to not have any weapons on the property.
And it sounds like Child Protective Services was telling you this would be the best interest in you and your family and the kids, based on the interaction that had happened at between JT and your father.
Yes, sir.
Have you since talked or learned from JT whether or not there was, in fact, a gun involved in that situation?
Yes, JT said there wasn't a gun.
So he's told you that now?
Yes, sir.
Now, State's Exhibit Number 54 is a temporary order where y'all scheduled to go back and to decide permanent custody between the kids.
Yes, sir.
I'm going to hand you what I've now marked as State's Exhibit Number 55. State's Exhibit Number 55. Do you know when the permanent custody hearing was to take place?
April 4th, 2014.
And so at that time, y'all were going to work everything out in terms of when the kids are with you and when the kids are with the defendant?
Yes, sir.
Did the April 4th permanent custody hearing ever take place?
No, sir.
What happened on that day?
I'm not sure. I can't recall.
Well, let me ask you, in looking at this document, it appears that one of the documents in State's Exhibit number 55, is a request to recalendar that hearing until June. Do you recall that that's
yes,
what
sir.
Happened?
Yes, to a later date.
So who made the request to recalendar the permanent custody hearing until June?
I'm not sure.
Did the permanent custody hearing ever take place in June of 2014?
No, sir.
What had happened between April 4th and June 9th?
Nathan murdered my parents April 9th.
Latonya, at some point, do you now have permanent custody of all three kids?
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Your Honor, this time I would ask to introduce State's Exhibit 55 and evidence the calendar request. Mm-hmm.
All right, 55 is allowed.
Thank you, Latonya. I know that was a lot of paperwork to go through there.
Let's pick up on February 10th. As of February 10th, JT was staying with the defendant and the girls were staying with you. Were you still communicating with the defendant regularly about the kids and how they were doing?
No.
Okay. Were y'all just doing the
weekends?
The weekends?
Yes.
Was the defendant still asking to contact you?
No.
So at that point, he's pretty much leaving you alone. You're leaving him alone.
Yes, sir.
When is JT's birthday?
April 5th.
And on April 5th, did the defendant start to make some inquiries to you and whether or not you would go to JT's party?
Yes, sir.
All right. Tell us about that, Latonya.
He really wanted me to come to JT's birthday party, and at first, you know, I had agreed to come and help out. I didn't feel comfortable coming, but I think he was going to have it at his home, and I said I would help, and then I ended up changing my mind and not going.
And how did the defendant contact you about going to JT's party?
I think he called me, I know JT called me. I was asking if I was going to come or not.
And so that was a weekend that JT was supposed to be with the defendant?
Yes, sir.
How about the girls? Was that one of the weekends they were supposed to be with him?
No, sir.
Did you let the girls go, though?
Yes.
So you let them go to their dad's house for the weekend?
Yes, sir.
To go to JT's party?
Yes.
You said you didn't feel comfortable going. Why didn't you feel comfortable going, LaTanya?
I mean, we had the restraining order in place, and I didn't want him to feel like, you know, I just didn't feel comfortable with the restraining order in place. He would want to talk. He would want to, you know, carry on. I didn't want that at the time.
Were you making any attempts at this point, LaTanya, to reconcile with the defendant?
No, sir. Okay.
Was he trying to reconcile with you up until this point?
No, sir.
What was the reaction that you got from not going to the birthday party, both by JT and the defendant?
I know he was upset that I didn't come, but I had JT the week prior, and I did something for his birthday, just us, and I got him something for his birthday, so we spent our time the week before. So,
how about the defendant? Did the defendant reach out to you and let you know whether or not he was upset about you coming or not coming to the party?
I think he was just saying, that's messed up, you couldn't come to your son's birthday party. He was upset.
All right, let's move from April 5th until April 9th. Okay. Anything unusual happened between April 5th and April 9th between you and the defendant?
No, sir.
And I believe April 9th was a Wednesday. So on April 9th, who would the girls have been with?
They were with me.
Let's tell me a little bit about what Amber and Nautica did on April 9th. What was their normal routine on a Wednesday?
At that time, I was working some overtime, so I had to leave out really early in the morning. So I didn't get to interact with them that morning. I left out really early and went straight to work. When I got home, you know, they were in a good mood and happy and just got home from school.
And what grades were they in at this point?
Fourth grade, and let's see, third grade and probably fourth grade.
But they had come home from school that day?
Yes, sir.
Who took them to school?
They rode a school bus. My dad took them to the bus stop and got them off.
And then what were they doing after school? You know, third and fourth graders, I don't know if they have a whole lot of homework.
Homework. Looking at TV.
What time did you get home, if you recall?
I think I got home around 6 o'clock.
Was your dad home when you got home?
Yes, sir. Okay.
What do you know what he'd been up to that day?
No, I think he was just, you know, around April 9th is my stepbrother's birthday. So I know he was on the phone talking to him, and I didn't have a lot of interaction with my dad or my mom because immediately when I got off of work, I got sick. I got really, really sick. And so I just went home and went straight to lay down. I wasn't feeling good.
So your dad was home, though, and you saw him. He appeared to be in good spirits.
Yes.
Okay. Nothing bothering him that day that you could tell.
No.
And so it was his son's birthday that
day. Yes.
How about your mom? You say you didn't see her much, but
she was. I think she was cooking or something and just preparing herself for Bible study on that night.
And she appeared to be in a good mood. Good spirits.
She said, I told her I wasn't going to go to Bible study at night. I wasn't feeling good. And she said, go ahead and lay down. I'll take the girls with me.
You said your mom's a pastor at this church.
Yes, sir.
I imagine you and your mom go to church quite frequently.
Yes, sir.
Was it unusual for you not to go to a Wednesday night service?
Yes.
And then you said the girls went with your mom to Wednesday night service.
Yes, sir.
Again, your mom in pretty good spirits when she left there.
Oh, yes.
What time did she leave, if you know?
She probably left around 7 because Bible study was at 7:30. So probably around 7.
And how far is the church from your house there?
It's about 15, 20 minutes.
What time was Wednesday night service? How long did it last there at your church?
It's from like 7:30 to about, she probably left around 9 or so.
That's the typical length of a service. You said your dad didn't
My dad didn't go.
Does he normally go on Wednesday nights or?
No.
Okay. He's a Sunday morning man?
Yes.
Well, so your dad's home. Do you know what he was doing while you were there alone in the house?
I know he talked to my brother. I heard him on the phone, but he came in the back of the room. He checked on me, and he was like, I hope you feel better. You know, he was just checking on me and went back in the kitchen.
You said you weren't feeling well that day. Was it just a headache?
I don't know. I instantly just got upset stomach.
Well, let me ask you about your day. What had gone on that day with you?
With me?
Yes, ma'am. Had you heard from the defendant that day?
He called my phone earlier that morning, and he was calling my job on and off. He called my job a few times. I didn't answer.
So you said when he called your phone, he called your cell phone?
He called my cell phone. I was on my way to work. It was really early in the morning, and he called my job.
What time did you have to be at work?
I think I went in... I was working overtime, so I think I went in as early as like 6:45 to 7.
And so you didn't answer the phone call to your cell phone?
No, sir.
And then you say he called you while at work?
Yes, sir.
Did he call your work phone or did he call your cell phone?
He called my work phone.
How'd you know it was him calling?
It came up on a call ID. Okay.
At any point that day, did you answer the defendant's phone calls?
No, sir.
How many times would you say approximately that he called you while you were at work?
Three or four times.
Did you know what he wanted that day?
No.
There wasn't some event coming up that weekend that y'all needed to plan for the kids?
No, sir.
Why did you decide that you didn't want to answer the phone?
I just didn't want to talk to him.
So no interaction with him at all that day that you recall?
No, sir.
Okay. Let's go back to the evening hours. And LaTanya, tell us a little bit about when your mom and the girls got home. What happened?
I was still laying down in the bed, and I heard them come in the house. I heard the girls laughing, and my mom, I think she was fixing them something to eat or something. But as soon as she got home, I would say about 10 minutes, I heard Nathan's truck pull up.
How'd you know it was Nathan's truck?
I know that sound. It's really loud. And he pulled up right next to the window. My bed was right next to the window where he pulled up at.
Were you expecting the defendant to be there that night at all?
No, sir.
Did you have any idea that he was coming over?
No, sir.
And did you have any idea that JT was coming over? If he was coming for a visit that night?
No, sir.
What happened after you heard the truck drive up?
I heard JT come in the house. He was talking to my dad, and then he just came straight to the back of the room and was like, jumped on me and was like, "Hey, mom." I was like, "Oh my God, I don't feel good." And he was like, I was like, "What are you doing here?" And he was like, "I don't know, Dad wanted to see you."
You said that you heard JT and your dad have some exchange when he walked in the house. You recall what they said to each other?
No.
Okay. But JT appeared to be in pretty good spirits.
Yes.
Where were the two girls at this point?
Nautica was in the room with me, and Amber, I guess, was in the kitchen or living room.
After JT kind of came in there and greeted you, what happened at that point, Latanya?
Nathan came into the home. I could hear it. and he was yelling in the living room, y'all don't want to talk to me. Somebody going to talk to me today. Y'all don't want to talk to me. And he was yelling, and then I heard gunshots.
And you said it was Nathan, or did you recognize it to be his voice?
Yes, sir.
The voice you've heard for 15 plus years.
Yes, sir.
How long after JT kind of came and jumped on your bed was it before you heard Nathan, the defendant, come into the house?
About two, three minutes. Right. I mean, as soon as he came in, not long.
And when you heard him yelling, y'all don't know, nobody wants to talk to me today, did you know what he was talking about at that point?
I just assumed because I wasn't answering my phone.
After he started yelling this, how long was it before you started hearing gunshots?
Right after he started yelling it.
Could you tell, LaTanya, where the gunshots were coming from?
The living room.
What did you hear at that point?
Gunshots. My mom screaming. Somebody running. And my mom yelled out, Seal, which is my dad's nickname, that she would call him. And I heard some more gunshots. I heard running through the house and gunshots outside. And that's when I called the police. I first tried to get the kids into my closet, and there wasn't enough space. So I told them to go into the next room, and I called the police and told him that my husband was here and he was shooting.
Could you tell how many people were running through the house, LaTanya?
Two.
Did you know what had happened out in the living room at this point?
No.
Did you ever see or hear from your mother again after you heard her scream out, Seal?
No.
And at this point, you said you picked up the phone and called 911?
Yes, sir.
You recall what you told him, LaTanya?
My husband is here and he's shooting. I need the police to 1125 Lake Glad Road.
And did you already have the kids in the closet when you made that phone call?
Yeah, I put them in the closet. I told them I love them.
What, who'd you see next?
Nathan.
Where was he? What'd he look like?
He came into the room. He had the gun in his hand. And he just started yelling at me, you don't want to talk to me? You don't want to talk to me? I'm calling you. You don't want to talk to me? And he started pistol whipping me. And I was just telling him, stop, please don't do this. And I said, I'll talk to you, bae. And when I said bae, he said, bae, oh, I'm your baby now. And he just started pistol whipping me.
When you say he was pistol whipping you, where was he hitting you?
In my head, my face, my ears. I remember like my ears shattering. And losing hearing in one of my ears. He was beating me in the face, in my upper body, and he wouldn't stop. I was just fighting.
At what part of the house was this taking place at this point in time?
In the girls' room.
Did the fight, or not the fight, but his assault on you, did it go into other parts of the house, if you remember?
No.
What were you wearing at that point, LaTanya, if you remember?
I don't remember.
What happened as he was beating you with the gun?
He kept beating me, and then the gun fired off. And I was just still fighting. And begging him, just take me away. I didn't want him to kill me there.
Why didn't you want him to kill you there?
I didn't want my children to see me dead.
How close was that closet to where you were being beaten?
I could reach out to him. It was right there.
Did you hear how they were reacting?
It was screaming. Nautica was screaming. Amber crying.
Said the gun went off one time. Where did that bullet strike you?
In my face, across my face.
Were you still able to struggle with him and try and keep him off of you after that first shot to your face?
Yes.
What happened then, Latanya?
I was down on the floor. I remember being down on my knees, and at that time I had lost eyesight in one of my eyes, and he was still beating me in the head and in the face, and then he stood over me and shot me.
What did you say before that shot went off?
Jesus.
And where did that shot hit you?
In my heart.
What's the next thing you remember?
Everything was real slow. I don't remember anything. I just remember going down, everything like in slow motion. And then I don't remember anything until the EMS workers was like standing over me, and I just can't breathe, and I just felt like I was on fire, like I was burning, and I couldn't breathe.
At that point, did you know whether or not your parents were alive or dead?
No.
And at that point, did you know whether or not your children were alive or dead?
No.
Latanya, when you say he was, standing over you, do you think you would be able to demonstrate that?
Yes, sir.
For the members of the jury and the court as to what position you were in and how close he was to you when he fired that second shot?
Yes.
Your Honor, that's permission for the witness to step down, and if she may demonstrate using me as to the position they were in when the shots, second shot came.
Yes, sir.
Latanya, if you can step down.
Can come right here in front of the jury. Make sure you keep your voice up so that you don't have the microphone. Just put me in the position that you were in after he was beaten.
I was on my knees.
Okay. This?
Yes.
Okay.
And he was right here. And he stood over me and shot me this close.
And you pointed the gun at your chest at that point and shot you?
Yes.
And for the record, you're standing less than 3 inches away from me.
Yes.
Thank you for the time.
At this point, we'll resume in 15 minutes. So at 10 minutes until 12, I'll ask the jurors to return to the deliberation room. Please don't discuss the case among yourselves, form express any opinions. No media or independent investigation into these matters. No conversations with parties, witnesses, or lawyers. If you'll leave your notepads in your chairs, just gather in the deliberation room in 15 minutes. Everyone else, please remain seated. we'll be in recess for 15 minutes.